May I speak to you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And who is my neighbor? The unforgettable parable of the Good Samaritan springs from a question. Jesus and the lawyer agree that loving God and neighbor is the summary of the life of faith. The lawyer has no follow-up questions for Jesus about what loving God means. The lawyer wants clarification about the neighbor. Who is my neighbor? There is a shadow side to this question, I think. The question implies, and who is not my neighbor? Who am I not responsible for? Who is it okay to leave outside the circle? Who is it safe to ignore? The lawyer is trying to establish where his responsibility ends. Wanting to justify himself, it says, meaning wanting to impress Jesus with how serious he is about doing the right thing, about living a faithful life. The lawyer wants the exact letter of the law. We might say, how do I limit my liability? Part of me wants Jesus to say, if you have to ask, the answer is yes. If we ask, is this person my neighbor? Jesus, it seems, is always going to say yes. But instead of saying this or something like this, Jesus being Jesus tells a story. If we are to imitate the Good Samaritan, we are the helpers. We are the people who give. We are the person who is healthy enough, strong enough, resourced enough to help and then go the extra mile. The privilege of being able to help emotionally and materially is a blessing. I think it can also become a temptation to feel heroic. It can flatter our ego, our need to be needed. It can be a limitless and exhausting role because there is need everywhere. Helpers can burn out and suffer from compassion fatigue. If we see ourselves only as a Good Samaritan, we might end up in the same place as the lawyer. We might end up wondering, where does my responsibility end? Because this is too much. I cannot be a good neighbor to all in need. I invite us to notice the other person at the heart of this story. If we are the wounded person, the story sounds very different. We don't have the choice, the ability to be the helper. We don't have the privilege of being the person with resources of health and wealth. All that was taken from us by the robbers. We're dependent on some neighbor, any neighbor, to help. Where is Jesus in this story if we are the one lying by the side of the road? We remember Jesus saying in Matthew's gospel, just as you did it to the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. In serving the wounded, we serve Jesus. Jesus is the Good Samaritan, but Jesus is also the wounded man, the person who cannot repay us, the person no one else speaks to or stops to listen to. Jesus tells us over and over again in the gospel, beware of seeing me in certain places and certain people only. So today, I invite us to see the whole story. Jesus is the Good Samaritan and the wounded man. There is as much holiness in being the receiver as the giver. Jesus is Savior, and Jesus lies wounded and beaten and shot and ignored in the streets of our cities. The grace of this parable is in the relationship of care. The divine beauty is in the coming together of strangers, in giving and receiving, in a new connection of humanity. For us, there is grace in tending to those in need, and there is grace in letting ourselves be lifted up by others when we are wounded and abandoned. There is grace in being in need. There is grace in sharing vulnerability. When we share our heart, pieces of our reality and our story, God is there. Thank God that we are on this journey with others. The truth is, we are all living with wounds these days. In addition to any personal circumstances that we're suffering through, personal losses, the world feels very unsteady because it is. We know all of those ways. Pandemic trauma, Supreme Court decisions that put us on a frightening path towards eroding freedoms and civil rights, climate change, the epidemic of gun violence linked with the epidemic of untreated mental illness, on and on. In times of trauma, God doesn't abandon us. One of God's greatest gifts is each other. We can be, we have to be, good Samaritans to each other. And we can remember that Jesus teaches that there is grace, not shame, in being wounded. Now, I know where I would rather be. I would rather always be the helper, not the wounded one. It's very American to seek the illusion of complete independence. A fear that many people have as we age is losing that independence and becoming some sort of a burden on others. Where can there possibly be any grace, we think, in being a burden? How humiliating that is, we think, in human terms. But maybe one of the things this story opens up for us is that there might be grace even there, in being dependent on others. I mean, why is the Good Samaritan doing this in the first place? No one else is there to see. Plenty of supposedly good people, faithful people, pass by on the other side. It's not the Samaritan's job, like it's the innkeeper's job, to take care of him. The Good Samaritan is doing this because he chooses to. And it seems that there's no resentment because he does go that extra mile. He doubles back to settle a tab at the inn. Perhaps the Good Samaritan experiences it not as a burden, but as a gift to be able to help. Perhaps it is a gift to give others an opportunity to go above and beyond. An example of this that stands out for me in my own recent life happened a couple of years ago, 3 years ago now. I will always remember with gratitude the staff at the amazing care facility in England where my mother spent her last 18 months of life. I was visiting, it was her last days, and it was obviously her last days, and I knew it was time to give my mom her last communion, but there wasn't a clergy person around except me, and I didn't have anything with me except my Book of Common Prayer. The staff were so helpful. I asked them for bread and wine, and they brought a little glass of wine. And instead of simply bringing bread, they actually cut out some little circles of brown bread to serve as wafers. And then they stayed at the bedside to share in our Eucharist together. That's above and beyond, especially bringing the little circles of brown bread, because they knew that that is what a communion wafer would look like to my mother. Such grace. It is graceful when we learn to receive the help of others. Of course, not everything graceful is easy, especially to those who like to be in a position of being the helper, not the helpee. And yet, in the continuum of human life, we are interdependent. And it seems that part of our faith journey on earth, part of our pilgrimage, is learning to rely on God and our neighbor. It seems that for Jesus, neighbors are always in our path and never in our way. Jesus gets underneath that whole question of liking our neighbor or not. It doesn't seem to matter to Jesus whether we like or feel sympathy or connection with the neighbor in our path. What matters to Jesus is that we choose to act in a loving way. And it seems that when we act with love, liking can often follow because there is that depth of relationship. Finally, the Christians that I knew in high school and college were the oddest, most uncool, most unsophisticated people on campus, both in England and in Scotland and in America, the campuses I was present on. I didn't count myself among the Christians at that time, but I was curious about their group behavior. They hung out together, but unlike other groups of young people, they seemed to have no standards of admission at all. There was always an open welcome at their table in the dining room, refusing elitism, eschewing gossip, just being kind and treating everyone the same. At the time, I thought that was nerdy and dorky. Those Christians, no standards at all. But may we go and do likewise. If the church can be like that, if we can be the authentic, compassionate, grace-filled community that Christ calls us to be, if we can live that way together, Jesus will once again turn the world upside down through people and churches just like us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.